go now to something a little more serious, because I remember, and I'm sure you remember our interview years ago, you had just lost your son.
Ah.
I want to talk about my child. He left us because he received a failing grade in constitutional law at Ateneo.
If you were able to talk to him in a seance or just face to face for about a minute, ano pong sasabihin niyo sa kanya?
Unang hinagpis.
I don't know where my son is. I don't even know if he is still alive for. Kung alam ko lang na ganyan ang swerte ko, hindi na ako nagpakagaling bilang estudyante o bilang isang abogada. Wala din palang kwenta eh. What can be more important than a child? What?
To this day, when people ask me what the most compelling interview was for me, I think that that was one of, that was always at the top of my list. And at that time, you had just lost your son. It was really a Miriam who was really almost totally dark. I mean, if I were to recount those days, it was a Miriam full of grief, almost totally devoid of faith, if you would ask me. You were enraged quite a bit. And it's been many, many years since then. Have you come to terms with that part of your life?
I don't understand why God can be all love and still inflict this kind of pain on people. This God is an underachiever. He does not do what he's supposed to be doing, whatever his sex is, whether it's an it or a he or a she or whatever. But I'm sure that if you were a God or I were the God, I'd be doing a better job. Therefore, the only conclusion can be that possibly God does not exist. There is no proof that God exists, but there is no proof that God does not exist. So there we are. You have a choice.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see God's handiwork in my life.
Mm-hmm.
Everything I got by hard work and by praying to God. Maybe because the prayer did not change the mind of God, but changed my mind.
So you continue to pray?
I don't pray like the atheist in the joke who says, God, if there is a God... Please send me to heaven if there is a heaven.
Okay. So how do you pray?
I don't pray like that at all. I don't believe that God is a man in white flowing robes who roams the universe carrying his big staff with a beard and looking down on little humans and then sending it. And when we pray to him, like a telegram sends us, you know, a text message and everything will be all right. I don't
Okay.
I don't have that concept at all.
So did this concept of faith or religion change upon the death of your son?
Oh, absolutely. Because then I began to think of all the mothers who had lost their sons, like during warfare, for example. And then all mothers who lose their children because of sheer poverty, couldn't buy the drug, couldn't afford the doctor, etc. In other words, I came face to face. It was eyeball to eyeball with the problem of evil, which when I was in theology school, I adopted as a concept that was part of the world as we know it. Evil is just there. We have to take it for granted. So after the death of my son, I began to question the presence of evil. Just I began to question the presence of God, because you really cannot reconcile these two forces. If a prayer helps to give comfort to the individual, I don't see anything wrong with it. But I cannot accept as an intellectual that prayer changes the mind of God. If God is omnipotent, no amount of praying is going to change his or her mind.
When you think about him, how does that thought end, usually?
I just don't think. I've trained myself not to think. I just have a big X sign there. Don't go there. Because it creates all kinds of intellectual difficulties for me, particularly in my faith.
So do you believe that people are defined by how they are transformed by either love or loss?
Oh, absolutely. In my life, yes, I can bear witness to that. And then, you know, there's a saying, life is a consequence of our moral choices. You make a moral choice. I entered politics. then politics killed my son, because some people hated my politics and they humiliated him during the interview period, notwithstanding that he had passed the written exam. He had been a dean's lister in undergraduate school. So basically, I had determined the fate of my son by my choice to enter politics. Life is a consequence of our moral choices. Mm-hmm. So what I'm asking is, why someone else had to bear the pain for what I had decided? I don't know whose fault. I don't think I'm at fault. I'm a very good lawyer, Korina, whether you believe it or not. And if I die and there is a last judgment, I certainly will stand up and raise my finger and say, you know, as I was telling you, this is not the way to do this thing if you wanted to achieve it. Mm-hmm. But in any event, I just don't think of my son. I think that's just, it has changed. Of course, it was life-defining. It has changed the way I see the world and see myself. I've never thought highly of myself. I don't think highly of any human life whatsoever, even the Nobel Prize winners and all these presidents. Who will remember these guys? Mm-hmm. Why do people want to be, so strongly to become president of the Philippines? Nobody will remember them. Mm-hmm. Nobody will remember me except my husband and my child. And when they die, nobody else will. Mm-hmm. So there's no point to human life. Whether you're in control or whether life is random, you are not, you cannot control things. Mm-hmm.